Can I have to do all?
This is Kathy's.
All right, well, good afternoon, everybody. This is number three of a week of rehearsals. Yeah, that too. A week of concerts. And always the Friday one is the one that they're the most relaxed. Is that true? I think so, because they've been through it twice. And I was doing a little bit of homework and went back into the records, and this is the 10th annual spring concert for this group. The first one was 2011, so that doesn't count up, right? They didn't do one in 2020, and they didn't do one in 2021 for reasons we all know. So this is their 10th. This is their 10th annual, and I'm getting to that. I'm going to ask which of the group was here for that very first time. So we've got some pioneer singers. So if you look at your program, we've got quite an interesting theme: songs that tell a story. And this is a very entertaining program, and they've been working very hard. It's not only entertaining, but it's very challenging. Agree? Yeah, they have worked very hard. But first, let's take care of the housekeeping stuff. If you've got phones, could you please silence the phones? And then you know what this is, the evacuation procedure, which I think you all already know by heart, but I guess I better read it. Yeah, you know what? I really don't feel like reading it. Are you guys up for some sort of challenge?
Yes.
Well, why don't you sing it to us then?
Styles, and in case you were wondering, the order of the songs is also the order in which the songs were written. So our first tale is the age-old story of the biblical prodigal son, but this time told from the perspective of an Irish drinking song. A child takes his portion of a family fortune, squanders it in booze, and he returns home to drink some more. Now, where did he get his money from? That's not disclosed. We just know he comes back with enough to party some more. Whatever the case, if you've ever been in an Irish pub, you probably have heard this song, and it does have a spot for audience participation. There's a part of the song, the chorus, it goes, and it's no name, never. And that's where you guys clap along. All right, can we just give that a try? And it's no name, never. That's the extent of it. All right, let's do it.
No more.
next song of the afternoon may also have been sung in pubs and bars, if you can believe it. This one was published in 1599, and the story is pretty simple. There's a fellow named Amyntas who is wandering up and down looking for his fair Phyllis. And she's off tending her sheep alone, and when he finds her, they fall a-kissing and a-kissing. And it's a small group coming up to sing it, so while they're coming up, I'll tell you a little bit about the genre. It's an English madrigal from the European Renaissance era, and this genre is famous for its ability to tell a story just by the way the notes move in the song in a technique called word painting. For instance, when Fair Phyllis is all alone, then just the sopranos are singing alone by themselves. When Amyntas is looking for Phyllis, then none of the voices are singing at the same time. They're searching around. And when he finds her and they kiss, then you only hear two distinct moving voices and the harmony is sweet. So as you're listening to this one, see if you can find any more techniques of word painting. Ballad, but this one tells the sad story of a woman left by her lover and her mourning that loss. What is strange about this song is that the tune is almost discordantly cheerful. This song was written in 1787 and it's been a staple of classical and folk repertoire. It was arranged by Benjamin Britten and Percy Grainger as orchestral arrangements. And it's even been in many TV shows and movies, including the late 90s Buffy the Vampire Slayer and 1960s Disney's Pollyanna. So, early one morning.
Oh,
because for this one I talk a lot. Our next three selections are all European songs from the Romantic era, and the first two were written in the exact same year, 1841. Chorus of the Hebrew Slaves is from the Italian opera Nabucco by Giuseppe Verdi. And before I tell you about the plot, I wanted to tell you a little bit about the genre opera, because it's a great history. And now I know many of you are thinking, oh great, opera, they're gonna put on their big old Viking hats and her Valkyrie hats and sing really loud. But actually, the genre opera was originally created by kind of like a think tank of philosophers. And they were like, oh, you know that madrigal, like that Fair Phyllis song we just listened to? We hate that. Like, that's like the worst music of all time. Because really all that cutesy up and down word painting, it doesn't mean anything. It doesn't make you feel anything. And so they wanted to make the audience really feel deep emotion, and they created this genre. And then they needed to come up with some composers that were crazy enough to write opera, which they did. They found some, opera really took off. It was a great hit. Along comes Giuseppe Verdi, and he's like this Italian nationalist, and he even got elected as a statesperson in a surprising second wind of a career. Now the words to this piece are based on the Bible passage from Psalm 137. By the waters of Babylon we sat and wept, on the willows there we hung up our lyres. Now at the time, knowing Verdi, the audience would have assumed it was about the creation of the Italian state, finding an Italian homeland. But today, we tend to take it at face value. These are Jews separated from their homeland, wanting to return to Zion. Now, however you hear the story, we hope that it fills you with deep emotion. Thank you. written in the same year, and this one tells the story of a romance that lingers long after the two lovers have died, and a hawthorn and a rose bloom and grow entwined from their graves.
Known as Forest Scenes, and I guess at about the same time, in the same place he was writing this, the Grimm brothers would have been collecting fairy tales. So You can think of it as a kind of a fairy tale for the piano, but there are no words, so I don't know what the story for this one would be. But apparently, according to the title of the piece, there is one. So, yeah.
Tune. Are you guys ready?
Yeah.
Right. We're taking this very seriously. We will be giving out prizes afterwards, so don't try to like sneak up and try to read the music or anything like that, okay?
Never leave her in the face of games. You We just have wonderful Dorcinda to teach us how to sing, and we have a really good time. So when we start again in September, I hope some of you will come with us.
We even have wild antics in the back row. I don't know if you guys saw that. They feel comfortable enough now. They don't even ask me these things. They just bring balls and throw them around. All right, our next piece is Keep Us in the Era of 20th Century American Folk Songs. We'll be singing John Henry, and that is the famous hero, most likely a legend, of an African-American steel driver who made a contest that he could drill faster by hand than the newfangled steam-powered rock drilling machine. He did win, but only at the cost of his heart giving up.
John Henry was a steel driving man. John Henry.
after that one. Our final two songs are two songs that demonstrate how songs can take on multiple meanings. So the first one is Dusty Old Dust, and it was written in 1935 by Woody Guthrie. And it was about the poor farmers living in the Dust Bowl era in a life of poverty. But then he was like, oh, I like that song. I'm gonna use that same tune and write a new song. And he wrote it to be about an anti-war song about World War II. So then the next one we're gonna do after that is Puff the Magic Dragon. And this one was written in the early 1960s. And it is a simple song about a boy growing up and putting away his childhood fantasies. Yet, some hail it as a song about smoking marijuana and puffing on the magic dragon who lived by the sea that stands for cannabis. What do you guys think? So after we gave the first concert on Monday, somebody apparently was like, that's nonsense, I've never heard that. And then when we gave the concert on Wednesday, they were like, of course it's about that. Now, more sinisterly, in the Vietnam War, there was a gunship that was named Puff the Magic Dragon for lighting up the sky with a red glow. So some people can't hear the song because of that anymore without thinking of it that way. So if you talk to the songwriters though, the words of Puff the Magic Dragon should be taken at face value about childhood innocence and growing up.
We grow up and we grow.
To our concert and being a great audience. And I want to ask you to give a big hand to the choir for their commitment and hard work for this concert. So please. There are a lot of people here that work behind the scenes too to make this concert possible, and so please read about them all in your program. Two people I wanted to mention for sure are Marion, who's in our audience today, former conductor and director, and Bill, who has been doing, both of them have been doing sectional rehearsals throughout the weeks that we've been working on this. So thank you so much. And of course to Gretchen and our president and you name it, the list goes on. So thanks to all those people. Our last song today is the story of being here, about coming to Woodland Pond and making it home. It was written by resident Dick Berry, who was here on Wednesday, but I don't see him today, right? Okay. And it's written to the tune of California, Here I Come. And the lyrics remind me that I, for one, am glad to be on the periphery of this great community. Oh, and when we're done, there's no real fanfare or anything, but I do know that there are cookies and snacks outside. So please stick around and mingle. And again, thanks for coming.
Thank you. Let's sing out in love.